The reduction of the absorber layer thickness in solar cells has been one of the most important research and development topics. The objective is to reduce the use of the expensive material and consequently the cost of commercial crystalline silicon solar cells. Is it possible to reduce the absorber layer thickness by half or even more while still maintaining a high efficiency solar cell? In this last video about the physics and engineering of solar cells, I would like to emphasize the importance of the thickness of the absorber layer and its influence on the performance of a solar cell. The key challenge of the photovoltaic industry is to bring down the production cost of solar cells and modules. An important aspect of bringing the cost down is boosting the efficiency of solar cells with less material usage. The final objective is to lower the price of solar electricity. The aim is to achieve solar electricity prices that are lower than prices of electricity generated from fossil and nuclear fuels or by other electricity generating technologies. Once again, we can see in this slide the three design rules for obtaining high efficiency solar cells. The energy utilization of solar spectrum is mainly determined by the band gap of the absorber layer. In order to absorb all photons that can generate electron hole pairs in the absorber, we would need a very thick absorber. However, the efficiency of solar cells also depends on the collection of charge carriers that are generated in the absorber. The collection is determined by the recombination of charge carriers. If the absorber layer is too thick, the chance that the photogenerated carriers recombine is pretty high. From this example, we understand that the optimal thickness of the absorber is a trade-off between having high absorption and also a good collection. At this point, light management comes into play. By using light trapping techniques, a higher light absorption can be achieved with a thinner absorber layer. The optimal thickness of the absorber layer is a compromise between light absorption and charge carrier collection. Here we see a schematic figure of a typical crystalline silicon solar cell. A typical crystalline silicon solar cell is based on a P-type silicon wafer, which is the absorber layer with a normal thickness of 150 up to 300 micrometers. The N-type layer is illustrated in light orange. The N layer is called the emitter layer, and it is much thinner than the bulk P-type absorber. Usually the N-type layer is in the order of 1 micrometer. As discussed before, a large fraction of light is absorbed close to the front surface of a solar cell. The photons in the near-infrared region has a low absorption coefficient and penetrate deep into the solar cell before they are absorbed. Once the photon is absorbed, an electron hole pair is generated. Electron is represented by a red circle and hole by a white circle. Since the absorber layer is P-type semiconductor, holes are the majority carriers, and therefore the probability that they recombine in this material is very small. However, electrons are minority carriers in this material, and therefore they need to be separated from holes and collected in the N-type layer. So let's follow the minority carrier, in this case electron, whether it can make it to the depletion region at the P-type, N-type region junction. Since most of the absorber is a quasi-neutral region, electron has to diffuse to the depletion region. In the animation, electron moves around but eventually encounters a hole. This encounter is fatal for the electron, and the electron recombines with the hole. This photogenerated electron is lost and cannot contribute to the energy conversion process. The average distance photogenerated electrons in the p-type wafer can travel before being recombined is known as the minority carrier diffusion length. When the minority carrier diffusion length is smaller than the thickness of the absorber layer, there is a high chance that many of the electrons generated deep in the absorber layer will suffer from recombination. These electrons will not reach the depletion region and will not be separated and collected in the n-type layer. From this example, we understand that it makes no sense to have a thick absorber layer when a large amount of photogenerated carriers cannot be collected due to the recombination. Part of the absorber that is designated by a pattern will not contribute to the energy conversion process, since the photogenerated electrons have very small probability to be separated and collected. As a result, the thickness of the absorber layer has to be optimized and has to be smaller than the minority carrier diffusion length. The electron diffusion length is generally in the range of 100 to 300 microns. That's why a practical crystalline silicon solar cell has the p-type wafer with a thickness in the order of 100 to 200 microns. When optimizing the thickness of the absorber layer in a solar cell, we must know very well the quality of the absorber, in this case, silicon wafer. This quality is expressed in the minority carrier lifetime or diffusion coefficient. So, how does the light absorption relate to the layer thickness? The fraction of light that is absorbed in a slab of semiconductor can be calculated using the Baer-Lambert's law. This law states that the light intensity decays with the exponential function of the product of the absorption coefficient and the traveling path of photons. From this equation, we can easily calculate that when we want to absorb 90% of light with a wavelength corresponding to the bandgap of crystalline silicon, we need more than 2 meters, and I repeat, 2 meters thick silicon wafer. This will never make a working solar cell. However, we fortunately have tricks how to enhance absorption. We call these tricks light trapping techniques. By applying the efficient light trapping techniques, such as ideal back reflector or Lambertian light scatterers, we can increase light absorption in the wavelength range of weak absorption by 4n squared. And here is the refractive index of a semiconductor. In case of crystalline silicon, a theoretical light absorption enhancement can be of factor 50. With the help of light management techniques, we can keep the absorber layer thin and enhance the light absorption. The absorber layer thickness has a huge impact on the electrical performance of a solar cell. As we just discussed, the average distance of a minority carrier that can travel in material and survive is determined by the minority carrier lifetime. The effective minority carrier lifetime is linked to the sum of the inverse bulk lifetime and 2 times the ratio of the effective surface recombination velocity over the layer thickness. We can tell from the equation that as absorber thickness is decreased, surface recombination tends to be dominant over the bulk recombination in determining the effective lifetime. This means that if surface recombination is high, the performance benefits of reducing the cell thickness will not be realized. The effective surface recombination velocity can be few centimeters per second to hundreds of centimeters per second. The open circuit voltage can be approximated to this equation with the assumption that the absorber layer thickness is less than the diffusion length. Good surface passivation will increase the effective minority carrier lifetime. Together with reduction of layer thicknesses, this will result in a high open circuit voltage and consequently higher conversion efficiency. Let's look at some simulation results to see how thickness of absorber can affect solar cell performance. These simulations were carried out for a crystalline silicon solar cell. First, look at the JSC thickness dependence. You can see here that as thickness increases, JC, or short circuit current density, also increases. This makes sense, since a thicker wafer will result in more photons being absorbed. However, you can observe that in this graph that the VOC has an inverse relationship with wafer thickness. This is due to increased recombination in the wafer. We have a trade-off between VOC and JSC when choosing an optimal thickness. So which effect dominates? In this figure, you see the conversion efficiency as a function of the absorber thickness. As expected, with a trade-off, there is an optimum thickness around 50 to 100 micrometers. This is the range where a solar cell can absorb enough photons for delivering a high short circuit current while keeping the open circuit voltage also high. To sum up, the optimal thickness of absorber layer in a solar cell is a trade-off between the absorption of photons and the collection of photogenerated charge carriers. The absorption is reflected in the solar cell short circuit current density, and the collection influences the open circuit voltage. A thin absorber layer can result in a high VOC in a solar cell, provided there is a good surface passivation of the absorber. The light absorption in the absorber layer can be strongly enhanced with the help of effective light management techniques. These techniques include surface texture, anti-reflection coating, and good back reflector. The three design rules for obtaining high efficiency solar cells, spectral utilization, material and interface processing, and light trapping, influence each other. All parts of a solar cell have to be carefully optimized from the perspective of the trade-off among these three areas.